Why do I live here?
Yeah.
I live here for several reasons. One, I do like to live close to nature because I feel nature helps make our consciousness more peaceful, more expanded. It's very good for writing, for creativity, for spirituality. And we have a beautiful landscape. We have extensive clouds that you can see, nice rocks. So it creates a very nice spiritual, natural setting. It's also very convenient. It's a few minutes from town. It's an hour from the airport. It has many cultural facilities. So I might say it has the best of both worlds, the spiritual world and the social world. Nice community, many spiritual groups. So it makes it an ideal place for being in nature, but being able to work with people and travel too. Well, for my own purposes, I have a special kinship that I feel not only with people, but also with nature. To me, the sky is alive, the clouds are alive, the trees, the rocks. It's all part of one greater being. So I like to be able to feel that on a daily basis. Living in the city, that's harder to do. You get caught more in the human world. And I also like space because space allows me to meditate. And also space allows me to write. It helps bring the Shakti and the creativity out. It's always growing and developing. The spirituality for me is like an inner flow of energy. It's like an inner current. It has its own movement, its own rhythms, its own time, its own consistency, and its own development. So it's not just a matter of studying books or doing practices. It's a matter of being in contact with that inner flow, which is also connected to the outer flow in nature, to the day, the night, the seasons, the moon, to the whole movement of life. I think you have to compensate in some ways. You do have beautiful trees. You do have parks. You do have the ocean. You do have plants. You can also take trips, retreats, travel. Pilgrimage. But I think you have to make a special effort not to get too involved or totally immersed in the human world. There's nothing wrong with being immersed in the human world, but it shouldn't so occupy us that we are not able to get into the greater universe around us. What is the relationship of Purusha and Prakriti, particularly in relation to the three gunas? Purusha is the conscious principle in the universe. It is the spirit that dwells in all things. Prakriti is nature in terms of form, movement, and energy. The two are always interrelated in what they do. Purusha pervades everything in Prakriti. The spirit pervades all of nature. The gunas are the main forces through which nature manifests and operates. They reflect the basic cosmic energies. Sattva is like the principle of light in the universe. Rajas is like the principle of energy in the universe. And tamas is like the principle of matter in the universe. They govern all things. They work through all things. They allow for the movement, the integration of spirit and nature. The Purusha is the pure consciousness, the inner self, the divine principle that pervades the entire universe. It also transcends the universe. It's also beyond time and space and action. In that sense, it is beyond the gunas. It is the witness of the gunas. It is the observer of the gunas. It is the power behind the gunas. Prakriti or nature works through the interplay of the gunas. Energy, matter, light, sattva, rajas, tamas, birth, growth, decay, death, all these movements in the cycle of time, in the development of energy, in the evolution of life forms, in the evolution of mind. So Purusha is not touched by those, but the embodied Purusha, the soul, which is the essence of our being, is touched by the gunas. On the inner level, we are connected to the cosmic Purusha, the divine being, beyond all manifestation. On the outer level, we work with the forces of nature or Prakriti. So the gunas affect us very intimately as an embodied being. But the essence of our nature in pure consciousness is beyond the gunas. So the essence of our being is beyond the gunas. We can always access that inner witness, that inner observer within us if we want to go beyond the limitations of the gunas. But in the field of the body and the mind and our life and our social expression, we have to learn how to work with the gunas. And the two factors are related. You cannot go beyond the gunas without understanding the gunas and being able to work with them and master them.
Thank you.
Well, first of all, let's go into the Sanskrit names for the gunas. First is the higher guna, which is called sattva-guna. Sattva-guna means the quality of being, the quality of peace, stability, harmony, balance, light, intelligence, virtue, beauty. We might say the higher aspect of the manifestation. And it relates specifically to the sphere of the mind, intelligence, the heart, the cognitive and the feeling principle within us. Second is the guna of rajas. Rajas refers to energy, turbulence, movement, and change. So rajas is the power that sets things in motion. On the negative side, it has the power to agitate and disturb things. In our nature, it relates more to the prana, the vital force, the breath, and the senses, the energetic aspects of our nature, movement, growth, and change. It can be a problem in excess because it can disturb us and agitate us, whereas the sattva always brings us towards more peace and balance. The third quality, the guna, is called tamas. Tamas means darkness, inertia, matter, sleep, rest, stability. So in our nature, tamas is the physical body. Tamas is the earth. Tamas is the ground. Tamas is the force that brings about stabilization, cohesion, and inertia, gravity. You might say it's gravity in the force of nature. So relative to the psychology, tamas becomes a problem because it can bring about more darkness, ignorance, sleep, inertia, dullness. So in terms of our human lives, we're talking about the gunas mainly as psychological qualities. And as psychological qualities, we have to remember that the mind, in the broadest sense of the mind, we mean the heart, the emotions, the feeling, the instinct, the intuition, every aspect of consciousness, is the sphere of sattva. So in the sphere of the mind, rajas and tamas become forces that can disturb us in the case of rajas, or in the case of tamas, they can have a darkening effect so that we cannot see or perceive the truth. So on the level of the psychology, which is the field of sattva-guna, rajas and tamas become factors of imbalance and disharmony. But in the greater field of nature, each of the three gunas has its location, its effects, and its place. You know, sattva, to go back, light in all of its forms. Rajas is not only energy, but also life. Tamas is not only matter, it's all the stabilizing forces. So we need all three forces, but in the field of the mind and the psychology, we need to cultivate the sattva guna as the primary force. What is the benefit of being aware of the gunas? Now, in Hindu thought, also in Buddhist thought and related teachings, there is a factor which we call the law of karma. We are, in our actions, setting in motion certain forces. For each cause, there is a certain type of effect. According to the law of karma, the effects of our actions not only result in consequences in this life, but also in future lives. Not only in our individual life, but also relative to the society and the world around us. The gunas are the forces in nature that carry the karmas. Sattva guna is those karmas that bring peace, harmony, balance, nonviolence, you know, receptivity, understanding, mutuality, openness, communication. Rajas in the psychology consists of those karmas that make us aggressive, that make us domineering, that in the extreme form can make us violent, that make us egoistic, proud, wanting to control, wanting to possess, wanting to dominate. So they set in motion karmas that bring about conflict, agitation, disagreement. Tamas consists of those karmas that are darkening in effect, that are based upon deception, dullness, ignorance, resistance to truth, inability or unwillingness to communicate, addictions, you know, factors in which we're not able to open up to others when we're not able to function in a positive way in the world. So the gunas are the vehicles for karma, and by mastering the gunas, we can learn how to master our karmas, make our individual lives better, our society better, and have a better impact on the greater universe in which we live, and help our soul move towards its greater goal of unity with the divine, enlightenment, awareness, connection with the universal consciousness. How do the gunas help me know myself better? Well, it's very interesting, you know, we talk a lot about self-knowledge in the modern world, and we have this whole business and institution of psychology, where we're very much involved with trying to understand ourselves and find out who we really are. According to Hindu thought, our true self is the cosmic being, the universal being. So to really know ourselves is to know the universe. To really know the universe is to know ourselves. So we are not just this psychological self of personal memory, personal reactions, and our ordinary human emotional reactions. We are the cosmic self. And to really know ourselves, we have to understand how the universe works. In the Vedic view, the entire universe is reflected in us. We are reflected in the entire universe. This is the meaning of the term Purusha, which is the cosmic being, the cosmic person, the self that is the entire universe. So in Hindu thought, we're talking about a deeper level of self-knowledge and self-awareness so that we can understand and integrate into the greater conscious universe, which means that we can also go beyond our personal, psychological, and social limitations. The gunas are the key to doing that because the gunas show us how nature operates, how our psyche operates, and how these two forces are interrelated. How can the gunas help us with success in the material world in which we live? First of all, we have to understand the gunas help us create peace in society, which is the first thing that we need. Sattva guna, when we cultivate that quality in ourselves, this ability to be receptive, to communicate, to understand others, to understand other cultures, other age groups, other nationalities, other ethnic groups, other religions, when we have that quality of receptivity and openness to the divine presence in all beings, to the universal connections, to the interdependency in all life, then we can go beyond our main social problems of crime, war, greed, disharmony, and imbalance. So I think that is the first point. Now, Rajas as a guna is the dominant guna emphasized in our society. We're asked to be aggressive, to be ambitious, to succeed. Each person is asked to have that accomplishment for themselves. It's sort of each man or woman for himself or herself these days. Now, Rajas has a place in giving us vitality, energy, and movement. But if we want to make it into something positive, we need to ally the energy of Rajas with the quality of Sattvaguna, the receptivity, the peace, the harmony, the balance, the selflessness. I mean, it's good to be able to accomplish something, but what are you doing it for?